Divine Truth Frequently Asked Question Session. Jesus, Mary and others provide answers to questions that are frequently asked by members of the media and public. This presentation is part of the Bible and Bible Quotation series. Mary asked Jesus to discuss the truth and error contained within the Bible and Bible verses about his identity claim and the second coming of Christ. The session was recorded on the 10th of March 2013 in Wilkesdale, Queensland, Australia. This is session 2, part 2.
Your teachings are quite confusing.
Yeah, that makes me laugh.
In the scripture, it says that there will be a second coming and Jesus will return to earth. During this time, the sky will turn red. I know that this is metaphorically speaking, but honestly, you being Jesus rejects a lot of statements in the book of Revelations, doesn't it?
It does. It definitely rejects a lot of statements in the book of Revelation. Firstly, the verse that the person is referring to is in Acts 2. And it's a quote from the book of Joel, which it says, "I will show wonders in the heavens above and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and billows of smoke. The sun will be turned into darkness and the moon to blood." So it doesn't actually say sun to red. The sun's already red or yellowish red.
The sky doesn't say that
in this verse. "Before the coming of the great and glorious day of the Lord, everyone who calls on the name of the Lord would be saved." Now, this verse was being used by the Apostle Peter for a start. In context, it was being used, Peter used it to explain what was happening at Peter's day right at that time. He was saying, Jesus, the Messiah, has already come and gone, right? And what we're doing now, which is sharing the truth to you in your own language, performing these signs of the Holy Spirit, this is proof that he's come and gone.
Yes, right. I see.
And this was foretold by the prophet Joel. So in context of what he was saying, he was quoting these verses not related to some time now in our modern age, but rather some about his day 2,000 years ago. That's the context of what the verse is being used in. So pulling it out of that context and applying it to another context is like a person, again, making some fairly great leaps in terms of the interpretation of their Bible. The context is Peter was applying it to what he was doing in his day, demonstrating through the gifts of the Spirit, as he called them, the truth of the prophecy of Joel. That's the main purpose. And proof that I had come to the earth already. So that's what he was using it for, proof that I had already come. So that's the underlying purpose of the verse. And again, I find a lot of Christians want to apply, they make these great leaps of verses into the modern era, mostly because they've been taught by their own ministers that there is this connection between the first century time period and the modern era. And so they feel that, that many verses in the Bible can be applied over and over again to different time periods. And if that's the case, and sometimes it is the case, then it means that it's very open to interpretation. Which it is. Now, this the problem is that it's basically saying, well, the person in this question is basically saying, because I haven't come in the way the Bible describes, then I can't be Jesus.
Yes. And also this person is saying that they're also saying it's a metaphorical statement about the sky turning red or the moon turning red.
Yep. So,
which is an interpretation as well, isn't
which
it?
Is an interpretation in itself.
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay.
And I agree that it is a metaphorical statement, but that is an interpretation.
Yeah.
And therefore a supposition.
Yeah.
Like the Bible doesn't say, oh, with regard to this verse, it's you need to interpret as a metaphorical verse.
Yeah.
The Bible doesn't give instructions to its interpretation. So there's nowhere in the Bible that says interpret this as metaphorical, interpret this as literal, interpret this as something else.
Yeah.
Or something to do with your future spirit life or something. Yeah. Like it doesn't give these kind of instructions. And I understand why it doesn't, because it would mean it would be three times as thick if it gave such instructions. But unfortunately, this is why there are so many Christian denominations, because every Christian denomination interprets every one of these verses differently generally. And as a result of that, they then come up with their own suppositions. And then, of course, they condemn me for saying that I'm Jesus because I don't match their supposition. I don't match even their supposition of what Jesus would do. Mind you, the Jesus of the Bible is a lot crueler and a lot more difficult a person than I am currently. So, but I don't match him, of course. So therefore they say, oh, you know, he can't be Jesus. Mind you, there are a lot of verses in the Bible that portray my character accurately and are exactly the same as my character now, but they don't use those to say, well, maybe he is Jesus, because they want to believe that I will come in a certain specific way. Now, my suggestion to people who want to believe the Bible is God's word, it is your right to believe the Bible is God's word and to believe that you shouldn't listen to anything else. That is your right, because you have been given free will. You're able to make that choice and decision. I would like to share with you what I have observed over 2,000 years of people making this decision. I have observed huge amounts of trauma for people who make this decision to believe that all of the Bible is God's word. I've observed trauma in their day-to-day life on earth before they pass, because they do not understand the truth of God's universe and how it works and how it impacts upon their own life. They do not understand how their choices and decisions have affected their soul condition as a result of believing some of the words of the Bible. As a result of that, when they pass into the spirit world, they've passed with a lot of trauma and a lot of difficulty in coming to understand the truth about the universe and about God. In fact, many Christians who have passed forget God altogether after they pass, because they are so disillusioned with what the Bible taught them. The Bible taught them untruth, but they assumed it to be true. And then when they found out that it was not true, they then discard not only the Bible, but any concept of God or any concept of love. And I've seen many Christians live in many years of torment in the spirit world as a result of them throwing away the baby with the bathwater, as the saying goes, the truth that's contained within, with the false things that are contained within. In addition, I've seen many people in the spirit world who are Christian, because of their false beliefs about the devil, their false beliefs about hell, their false beliefs that they can't get out of a condition once they've gotten into a certain condition, their false beliefs about my sacrifice, their false beliefs on what saves them, have all impacted for many long years their life in the spirit world. You've observed it as well, I know, darling. And so as a result of these observations, we can tell you categorically that if you choose to accept the Bible as God's word without any critical analysis, you are going to not only be severely disappointed in your future life, but you are also going to have a lot of difficulties in your future life unraveling the untruth that you've imbibed in your life as a result of believing that it's God's word. My suggestion is to do something completely different. My suggestion is to start with a clean slate in your belief systems for a change and analyze everything from logic, from truth, and from love, and particularly from logic and love. You don't know what the truth is yet. Assume you don't know what the truth is yet, rather than believing that what the Bible says is true. And then what you do is you look at it logically and look at it from a perspective of love. Now, if there's things in the Bible that portray things that are unloving about God, get rid of them. They are not a part of God's nature. They are not a part of your future, even if you don't want it to be. If there's anything that's out of harmony with logic in a normal logical situation, discount them, or at least temporarily discount them, assuming that you have not enough logic yet to determine what the truth is, rather than just accepting them by faith, as you call it. Faith is established not through a lack of logic or mystery. Faith is established through something actually happening. And this is very important to understand, for I believe every single person on the planet. Faith can only be established from what you know, and what you know can only be established through personal experience. It can't be established through anyone else's experience. It can only be established through what actually happened. So, for example, I know and I have complete faith that if I jump into the air, then I'm going to return to the ground. Right? Now, why do I know this? Because every single person that I know around me and my own life demonstrates to me that every time I've jumped into the air, I've come back to the ground. Mm-hmm. Now, there is the potential, if there was no gravity, that if I jumped into the air, I'd fly out into space. But, of course, that doesn't happen because of this law of gravity that always pulls me back to the ground. This causes me to have faith that the next time I jump, I'm not going to fly into space. So I don't walk around all afraid that I'm going to jump at some point and fly into space, because I know for certain that that can never happen. It's very much the same with your own faith. You can only know something for certain after you've had a personal experience of it. Now, many people who are on Earth, most people, in fact, that are on Earth, the majority, have never experienced the spirit world. You do not know what's going to happen in it because you've never experienced it. You cannot know until you've been there. Now, you could listen to some people who have been there, but the Bible precludes you from listening to those people.
Mm-hmm.
The Bible says that you shouldn't speak to a medium who's speaking to a spirit. So it actually stops you from listening to such people. So that severely limits your ability to determine truth. My suggestion instead of that is to listen to the people who have actually done something, and then if you don't believe it, see how you go, put it in the I don't know basket, rather than putting it in the it's definitely not true basket, right? And in my life, I have three baskets. I have an I don't know basket, I know for certain basket, and it's definitely not true basket. Now, everything goes in the I don't know basket until, for me, it enters the I know for certain basket or I don't know for certain basket. And my suggestion to every single person who's listening to these FAQs is to go, all right, instead of me thinking that this is God's word without knowing, because I don't know, I have no proof, no evidence whatsoever, aside from what it tells me. And even that's flawed. So I have no knowledge whatsoever of whether it's true or not. Instead of doing that, let's put all of that in the I don't know basket. Right? And then analyze things through this critical analysis of logic and love, firstly. If it's loving, then put it in the probably true basket. If it's unloving, put it in the probably false basket. If it's illogical, put it in the probably false basket. If it's logical, put it in the probably true basket. And in the end, you will end up with a series of teachings, which will be very, very close to what my teachings already are, if you want to go through that long-winded process of determining truth. Or you could just listen to a person such as myself who has been to the spirit world and who has had a connection with God and who does know what he was talking about and, in fact, who was the very founder of your faith, right? You could listen to him if you so chose. But if you're frightened to do that, then do this other thing. Put it in the I don't know basket and determine what is true and what is false through logic and through your reason and through your love.
And what about through lived experience? How does you're talking about the probablys, and once we then have an experience of these things, is that when they reach into the certainty baskets?
Yeah, it's impossible for us. If I can give an illustration of that, let's say I said theoretically I could walk through that wall, theoretically, because my body is made of atoms and the wall's made of atoms, and somehow if I could get my atoms in synchronization with the wall's atoms, there's a potential that I can walk through the matter of the wall. There's that potential.
Mm-hmm.
If I've never done it, I don't know for certain. It's when I do it that I'll say that's in the true basket. When I do it,
yeah,
that's when it's true. When you do it, that's when it's true for you. Right? If it hasn't happened for you, then it's not true yet. And don't assume that just because certain things have happened, it's because of your assumptions.
Mm-hmm.
Because there may be other explanations. Look at all of the possible explanations. A wise person will look at all of the possible explanations as to why they had a certain experience. So many people who are Christian have had an experience of receiving divine love. Don't assume it's because of your belief systems, because I know Christians with completely the opposite belief systems of you that have had the same experience. I know people who are not even Christian who have had the same experience. So you can't assume that it's based on your beliefs. It's got to be based on something else. And if you look at what was happening at the time, most of the time there was a longing in the soul. There was this desire in the soul to connect to God, connect to truth, you know, and this passionate desire in the soul that God's responding to. And God responds to it no matter what religion we are, no matter what faith or lack of faith we have,
yeah.
God responds to this desire. Now, we need to have an open mind about these matters before we determine what is truth. Now, a lot of Christians believe that the reason why they've had these experiences is because they believe the Bible is God's word. That's not the reason why. That's the assumption about the reason why, which is very different from a logical perspective than the actual reason. The actual reason is completely different, because people who are not believers in the Bible have had the same experiences, mm-hmm. which tells me that there must be something else going on other than just a belief in the Bible. These are the kind of things that need to be considered by the Christian who's sincerely analysing these particular matters. We have seen the results of a person holding fast to a strict set of beliefs, whether it's the Bible, the Quran, some kind of Hindu belief or Buddhist belief, that there is a very similar set of things that go on for them in the spirit world. We've seen the results of this. Our suggestion to you is to not do this, to understand that God's word can be written on your heart as long as you understand that God's word is infinite and you'll be continually growing in the truth of it. And you can only do that by entering this relationship with God, which is independent of any book. It's dependent upon the feelings that you have for God, the love you have for God and the love you have for your neighbour. That's what it's dependent upon. And the desire you have for God's love to enter you. That's what it's dependent mm-hmm. upon. And if you understand that basic truth, you will be able to put the Bible in the I don't know basket until such times as the different things in the Bible, some of which will come to turn out to be true and others of which will turn out to be completely false, you'll find in your future if you do that. But if you go down the track of going, the Bible is God's word, you are going to be severely disappointed in your future and particularly in your spirit life future. You're going to be severely disappointed while you hold on to such beliefs. We have seen the pain that these things cause people, and it is very unfortunate that it causes it, because there is a lot of truth in the Bible, but it is mixed with the error that people have included in the Bible because they wanted their own addictions to be met. And the difficulty is determining what is true and what is not. Mm-hmm. If you follow my suggestion that I've just given, you'll be able to work out what is true and what is not, rather than just believing that it is God's word completely. Anytime you ask me a question stating something in the Bible, my standard response is going to be, but I don't believe the Bible. What other proof do you have? And if you can't give me any other proof, then I'd suggest to you that perhaps it's not God's word. Because the proof will be in the universe. The universe is of God's creation. The proof will be there if it is God's word.
So let's look at this from a Christian perspective. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of people on the earth who have been waiting for you to come back for a long time.
I agree.
And they do all look to this book that you have been holding up mm-hmm. and talking about applying logic to and all of these things. Mm-hmm. Now, wouldn't it just be easy to fulfill some of those prophecies so all of those people would have more faith or understanding that you are who you say you are?
The problem is that many of these prophecies I am forbidden to fulfill if I have a relationship with God that's in love. Mm-hmm. I cannot come and destroy wicked, for example. It's impossible for me to do such a thing and maintain my own connection with God. It's impossible for me to destroy the wicked. I can't do it. So you're expecting me to do something that's impossible for me to do if you want me to fulfill what the Bible says. It's also, there are many things that it says I should do in the Bible that are not impossible but are highly unlikely, in the sense that I don't want to do them. You know, I don't want to judge mankind. It's possible that I can judge mankind. You know, I could sit down here and say, yeah, you know, Igor, who's behind that camera, he's a bit of a mongrel and he's a bit of this and he's that, or let's be more polite about it, he's really evil, as, you know, because he did this and that in his life. And I could do all of those kind of things. But why do I need to do such a thing when God's laws already provide any feedback system and corrective system to Igor? I don't need to do such a thing. Mm-hmm. Why would I want to? So the Bible says that I will become a judge, or that I am the judge. I don't accept such a thing. I don't want to be a judge, and I'm not a judge, and God's never offered me judgment, because I know God's laws as well as God does on the matter, and that is that God's already set up a system that automatically corrects people without their needing to be a judge. So there's many things that the Bible says I will do that it's impossible for me to do if I love God and if I understand God's love. It's impossible for me to remain at one with God and do them. So I can't fulfill many of the things the Bible says I should fulfill.
Isn't there a parallel? Isn't there a parallel between the Jewish tradition, believing in a set of books and waiting for a Messiah to come?
Of course.
And
what an irony. Like, I find this so ironic that here we have in the first century, there were men and women who believed in the Jewish Bible of the time, let's call it, what they believed to be God's word, the Torah and the prophets, and they were expecting the Messiah to come and to be a king over the earth, destroy the wicked, you know, install a righteous government with no end, and to have everyone on the earth in subject to him. That's what they were expecting. Now, how different is that to what the Christians are expecting at this point in time? Hardly any different at all, with the exception is they believe this entire thing is God's word in comparison to what the Hebrews believe, which is that is God's word, that part of it. That's the only difference. And with regard to their expectations of myself, they are identical. That's the irony. The irony is the Jews had the expectation that I would be some all-conquering king, warmonger, who destroys the wicked and establishes a government. The Christians believe that I'm going to be some all-conquering king who's a warmonger, who gets rid of all the wicked and establishes a government. And I never did such a thing when I came the first time, so why do you expect me to do such a thing when I come the second time? Of course I can't. And I can't. It's not that I won't, it's that I can't either. If I want to maintain a relationship with God of love, with love, and feel God's love entering my soul all the time as I do, I cannot do such things. It's impossible for me to take such actions. So I feel that's the irony of these expectations. The expectations in the first century were based around unloving desires, and the expectations now are based around the same unloving desires. Get rid of the unloving desires and analyse things from a more loving perspective, and you'll see who the real Jesus is. There are many thousands, hundreds of thousands of people who claim to be Jesus, both on earth and in the spirit world. You'll see who the real one is by his actions, not through any other means. I have to laugh when people say that my teachings are not logical. It just amuses me, like how illogical the teachings are of the people who accuse my teachings of being illogical. It just is outstanding. All of my teachings are so logical that a child generally can understand them. We've spoken to children who are 5, 6 years of age, and they understand them perfectly, better in fact than most of their parents do in the majority of cases. And so I feel that they are very logical teachings, very straightforward teachings, very easy to understand. The reality is it's the false teachings the person has already imbibed that prevent them from seeing the simplicity and logic in the teachings that we are presenting. And it's the false teachings that you have to unlearn that cause you so many difficulties with your future life. Mm. Yeah, and you had something to add to the question too.
Oh, I just had it's more of an aside. Because I'm not familiar with this person's thinking, saying that the sky will turn red metaphorically, what is that a metaphor for? Is that bloodshed or change?
Well, they don't explain that, and they probably don't personally know what the metaphor is for. It's sort of like that. The way they read it is that it's a metaphor. They'll agree that it's a metaphor, but many of the Christians then feel there has to be some external sign that's really out there and right in your face to show you that Jesus has come. So the people who do not believe in these particular verses as literal believe them to be metaphorical, but in the metaphor they feel that there has to be some huge outward thing that happens to prove that this person who's claiming to be Jesus is actually Jesus. So they're looking for some kind of miraculous sun, moon,
ominous
sky thing,
sort of thing, yeah.
But that which they view as a metaphor, so they don't actually expect it to happen in the sun, moon, or sky, but they do sort of expect it to happen somehow in their day to day life without having any real strong definition of what that might be.
Right. Yeah.
So I feel again, a lot of Christian theology is based around supposition and assumption, but also based around what people would want to see. It's sort of like feeding them excitement, keeping them excited for the day that Jesus returns without helping them understand how to determine when Jesus has returned.
Sure. Yeah. Okay, thank you. Regarding the hells, I'm not finding it easy to think of the existence of them without an evil being.
Right.
From the Bible in Genesis 1, God saw all that he had made and it was very good. We know that God created the heavens and the earth and he saw that it was good. In 1 John chapter 1, 5 and 6, which says, "This is the message we have heard from him and declare to you, God is light, in him there is no darkness at all. If we claim to have fellowship with him and yet walk in the darkness, we lie and do not live out the truth. So, from this we know that God is love and would not create or exist in darkness. So, I feel God would not have created hell, and according to you, Satan could not have masterminded hell, since he supposedly doesn't exist.
Exactly.
The people themselves would not be capable of doing it and or would not be motivated to want to for obvious reasons."
I can't agree with that, but we'll see what I mean by that.
"But they could not want to live there because they could not want to live there. So who or what sustains the hells or these hells? I get that the condition of the people caused them to be there, but something has to be holding it together."
Right. Well, that's a fairly long-winded question.
It's an in-depth question, yes.
A few paragraphs. Yes. But I understand the background. The person basically feels that there's got to be Satan the devil because there's no way for the hells to exist without there being one. That's basically the underlying concept. And they're basing this concept upon the Bible being God's word, of course, again. Now, there's probably quite a lot of points that I'd like to make, you know, about this subject that the person has raised. If we look at all the things the person has raised, there's quite a lot of issues and assumptions that they've made that I cannot agree with all the way through their question.
Okay.
And this is the problem with many questions, is the question itself often contains so much error that the presumption of the final question would never be arrived at if there was a knowledge of the truth in the other parts of the question.
So perhaps we should just start at the beginning of the question.
So we need to start at the beginning and work our way through.
Yeah.
Now, they make a statement through this question. They say somewhere, "From the Bible we know the truth that," and then off they go. Now, the first thing I'd like to say is we cannot state that just because the Bible says something, we know. We only know through personal experience. The only way that I could teach the truth in the first century, bearing in mind that I didn't have a Bible to work from, I didn't have, the Torah never told me the things that I told people, the prophets never told me the things that I told people. So how did I know? I knew by developing a relationship with God and going through this personal experience with God, so much so that God could write the word of truth on my heart and I experienced this truth, then I knew. That is the only way you know. You are never going to know no matter what a book tells you. Even if the book tells you the truth, you're still not going to know until you've gone through the personal experience of knowing. So you cannot make a statement, "From the Bible we know." You don't know it from the Bible whatsoever. Even if what the Bible says is true, you still don't know it until it's been a personal experience of your own. Now, for most people, part of this question, the hells have never been a personal experience of their own. They've never been there. They've never visited there. They don't know what they look like. They don't know what they're like at all. So how can they say they know anything? They've never personally experienced it. Now, in the spirit world, there's whole groups of spirits who have visited the hells. They know exactly what they like. They know exactly what they feel like, they look like, how they smell, how they taste even, everything. They know exactly everything about these hells. But no person on earth who's in their first incarnation knows such a thing. And that applies to everyone on earth aside from 14 people that I know, 13 now.
Yeah.
So the reality is that no person on earth can really state that they know from the Bible what the hells are going to be like.
Okay.
Until they personally have a look at them, they are not going to be able to even imagine them. Right? Now, we might be able to assist them, those of us who have visited those hells might be able to assist them to have some concept of what they would be like, but it's not until they actually go there that they'll actually know. Okay. It's not until their personal experience.
Okay.
Mm. So that's the first thing I'd like to say.
Yeah.
The second thing that the person brings up is in the Bible in Genesis 1, which says that God saw that he had all that he had made and it was very good. Now, I agree with that Bible statement. Also in 1 John 1, 5 and 6, that God is light and there is no darkness at all in him. I agree completely with that statement. The mm-hmm. Bible itself disagrees with it, saying that God is a God of wrath at the same time, which to me would be darkness. But, you know, those two statements from the Bible, I agree with completely.
Mm-hmm.
Therefore, while it was possible to create a perfect creature that falls due to its own choices, it is impossible for God to create a creature that could fall and never be redeemed.
Why?
Well, for Satan, a creature that cannot be redeemed to exist, God could not be perfect. God, in perfection, has created everything in perfection. This means that God has created a system where anything that falls can be redeemed.
Mm-hmm.
That it cannot permanently fall and never be redeemed. Now, most Christians have never considered this. They believe that God, somehow, even though perfect, can create a creature that would fall and then never be able to be redeemed. And this is a physical impossibility. If God is perfect, that cannot happen.
Mm-hmm.
If that can happen, then God is not perfect. So there is some kind of misinterpretation here and some kind of lack of logic here in the Christian faith. The reality is God cannot create anything other than a perfect system. If the system is perfect and a creature falls from grace, as the saying goes, then that same creature has the ability to return from the fall.
Mm-hmm.
This is what I was pointing out with the illustration of the prodigal son that is recorded in the Bible.
Mm-hmm.
Every creature that God has ever created has the ability to return to grace, has the ability to return from a fall. That's how perfect God's system is. It enables every single person who's ever sinned, who's ever committed badness, who's ever done wrong, to return from wrong.
Mm-hmm.
That's how it's corrective in nature.
And so this is really, in this point, you're pointing out why Satan cannot exist,
Exactly. Basically. Satan cannot exist because God has made everything perfect.
Yeah.
And because God has made everything perfect, God cannot create a creature that through its own will can fall and never be redeemed.
Mm-hmm.
God can't create such a system. And if you think that God can, then you believe in an imperfect God. Therefore, he's not God. So yeah, the logic or the lack of logic in such an assumption is very plain. For Satan to exist, God cannot exist.
Mm. So
if God does exist, then Satan cannot.
Gotcha.
And, of course, no spirit has ever seen a Satan, so they know that Satan does not exist. Yeah.
So then if we get to this person, in essence, this person is asking the question, really, if God made everything good,
mm-hmm.
what maintains the darkness?
Of course, yeah, and there's a lot of answers that we can give about that. So let's look at this assumption too. It says there's this assumption in Christianity that humanity is a flawed creation.
Mm, very much so, isn't it?
Now, that cannot be true if God is perfect. A perfect God cannot make a flawed creation.
Mm.
So if we believe the scripture in Genesis 1 that God said everything was good and perfect, and in John 1, 5 and 6 that there is no darkness in God, and there's only perfection in God, then we must also believe that humanity is not a flawed creation.
Mm-hmm.
We must assume that humanity is a creation that was exactly created as it was intended by God. So humanity, the way I see humanity, is that humanity is the pinnacle of God's creation, the pinnacle of expression of God's love, and is completely able to have free feeling and thought and then act upon the free feeling and thought, even if the action is out of harmony with God's laws and God's love. God gave this gift to humanity so that we would not be robots and that we would actually be free-thinking, sentient, I think they call them, beings. Beings that are able to make their own choices, whether those choices be good or bad.
And yet, as you say...
And that's not a flaw.
Well, most Christians...
Believe it is a flaw.
...believe that inherently we always make flawed choices.
We
have
we don't.
This choice... And we always choose bad things, don't they?
No, we don't. Though, do we? That's
well,
what they
no,
believe.
That's what they believe.
But the
though.
Majority of people on the planet, through the course of a day, can make many good choices. Not every choice is flawed. Mm-hmm. They do make flawed choices or bad choices too. But that is a based around their own will, their own desire, their own passion. It's not based around any flaw that God created. God created this beautiful gift, which we call free will, which is like a knife, right? It has a very, very good function, but only if we use it wisely. You know, if we use a knife unwisely, you can cause a lot of damage to the human body and other things.
Yeah.
So it's the same kind of principle.
And really you're saying that the design, so God's design in us, is not flawed in any way because we have the capacity to use our will perfectly.
Yes, we have the capacity to use our will perfectly in a good direction. And also very badly in a perfectly in a bad direction, but it's the usage of the will that is the important thing. God designed it as a design feature in the human soul,
yep.
Not as a flaw of the human soul.
Yeah.
So instead of coming from this question from the point of view of we're all flawed and you know we're all going to end up with some you know we've got to be careful because we're all flawed and all those kind of things. None of this is true. God designed the human soul as the pinnacle of God's creation. He gave the human soul the only gift that he never gave any of the other beings, and that is free will, the ability to make choices for itself.
Mm-hmm.
And the way the soul exercises these choices is completely dependent upon their own will, mm-hmm. like they're allowed to exercise their choice in any direction. But that doesn't mean that God created the possibility of anarchy in his universe. He gave your soul the ability to make a free will choice, but he created a universe that is unable to enter anarchy. So what he did is he created a structure in which your soul would live. And if your choice disagreed with the structure, you would feel the results of the disagreement, a feedback system, if you will, that you're out of harmony with the rest of the universe. You're allowed to be out of harmony with the rest of the universe because God gave you free will. It's not very wise, of course. If you're out of harmony with the rest of the universe, you're going to experience a lot of pain at some point in your future. But it's the thing that God designed you to have the capacity to do if you desired.
Mm-hmm.
And this is a gift. It's not a flaw.
Mm.
So this underlying Christian concept that it was a flaw, you know, that our heart is treacherous and who can know it, and we're bad from the moment we're born to the moment we die, and, you know, we've been bad from Adam and Eve onwards and all of these kind of things. A misunderstanding of God's nature and also God's creation. So there's this concept almost that God created. So far we've gone through two concepts. The concept that God created a flawed being such as Satan,
mm-hmm.
who could become, you know, flawed and leave God and yet never redeem itself, is in itself an imperfect concept.
Mm-hmm.
And then this concept that God would create humanity flawed when they began is also an imperfect concept. And certainly out of harmony with the truth about God.
Mm-hmm.
So there's two suppositions already from this question that are out of harmony with truth and logic.
Right?
So let's continue to the fourth point. This gift of free will, the ability to make choices, is the key thing. It's a natural consequence of this gift that there is an infinite number of possibilities that are of choices that we could make.
Yep.
Now, that means that we have the ability to make so many fantastically, perfectly positive choices.
Yes.
While at the same time, we have the ability to make, on the other hand, all these terrible, terrible negative choices.
Yes.
Right? Now, usually the same ability isn't exercised in the same soul at the same time, because usually if a person is in a very good development of love, they'll mostly or always make positive choices. And usually if the soul is not developed in love and has some misunderstandings, fears and other emotions about love, anger, rage and so forth, then the soul may make many very negative and evil choices.
Mm-hmm.
So they usually don't make good and evil choices at the same time because of the condition of the soul.
Yeah.
But we are free will people. We have the ability to make any choice we wish. This means, of course, that we have abilities to make evil choices. God gave us this ability. It's not an imperfect flaw. It's a design feature in our soul.
Mm, because inherent in the design is really teaching us about the difference, the consequences and the capacities of using our will in either direction.
Yeah, the consequences and the joys of using our will.
And we never lose the capacity to make good, loving choices.
Yeah. A different choice.
And that's a perfect design, isn't it?
Perfect choice, perfect design. And God makes perfect things as a person, as they grow towards God, begins to realize.
Mm.
So this concept of a limited God who created a limited being such as Satan, the devil, and created another limited being, the human being, and then had all these flaws in its creation, while at the same time the God itself being perfect, is a flawed concept.
Yes.
And it's also a concept that seems to prevail in much of Christianity, which is false. You know, so we can't make these assumptions.
Okay, so moving on.
Now, since God knew that there was a possibility of us making all these different choices, you would naturally assume that God knew that there was a possibility we'd make a lot of bad ones, and there was a possibility we might make some good ones.
Mm-hmm.
That makes sense, does it not?
Definitely.
Now, God, in knowing this, then had to find a place where we could live if we had made bad choices and a place where we'd live if we made good ones.
Mm-hmm.
And so what God did was create another set of laws that create the location that mirrors the choice that we've made.
Or the cumulative effect of all the choices we've made.
It's not only the cumulative effect of all the choices we've made, it is also the individual choices we make create different locations.
Great. Yeah.
So in the end, we've had a life of choices, some good, some bad, some good, some evil, let's call them.
Yeah.
When we pass into the spirit world, we have created a location that mirrors the choices we've made.
Mm-hmm.
Now, if through the choice of my life, I've chosen through my life to exercise my will in a negative direction, I've chosen to murder a few people, go to war a few times, rape a few women, and done a lot of other things like that, then when by the time I pass, the location that I pass into will mirror the choices I've made. It will be a complete reflection to me of the choices that I've actually made.
Mm-hmm.
Now, that place isn't going to be a very pleasant place. It's probably going to be populated with other people who have made exactly the same choices. It's going to be populated with things around me that remind me of the choices that I made in order to correct those choices. That is a perfect system.
Mm-hmm.
So we create, through our choice, our own hell, which is a physical location and an emotional condition at the same time. We create through our choices. And it's not right to say that we would have chosen something different, because many people, knowing good, still choose bad. So it's not right to say that they would have chosen a different location. Now, perhaps if they were aware that they were creating a location in which they would eventually live, they might have made a different choice.
Mm-hmm.
But most people on the planet, because of the lack of awareness on the planet, are not aware. And because they don't want to hear from the spirit world, there's plenty of people in the spirit world who want to tell you.
Yeah.
And, you know, like I said in the illustration of the rich man and Lazarus that's recorded in the Bible, you know, the rich man wanted someone like Lazarus to go back and tell his family, look, if you keep doing these things, you'll end up where I am. And there's plenty of spirits in the spirit world who want to tell you that.
Yeah.
That if you keep doing these things, you'll end up where I am. But most people on earth have their hearing turned off to the spirit world. And in fact, the spirit world hearing is condemned by most religious faiths. And as a result, they can't hear these spirits saying, but, don't do this, don't do this. If you keep doing this, you'll end up where I am, and where I am is not nice, trust me. Mm-hmm. You know, that's what they want to say,
mm-hmm.
but they can't say it because they're not allowed, because the people on earth don't want to believe it, and because the people on earth don't want to listen. So it's very important for us to understand that God did not need to create the physical locations.
It's really the result of our choices interacting with the laws that God has already put in place.
Exactly. All God needed to do is create the framework for the location to exist,
mm-hmm.
and our choice would determine what location is created. This is a very powerful thing God has done, a very beautiful thing, in fact. God has created it so that every place we finish up living is the ideal place for a person in our condition to live. The hells are the ideal, most loving location to place a person who is killed or raped or, you know, done anything like that. The hells are the ideal. Any addiction we have, our addiction will be met in the location that we've created.
Mm-hmm.
That is the most loving thing for God to do, right? Until such a time as we're prepared, and when I say our addiction will be met, I mean the things that we've created will be reflected back to us in the creation through the location we've created through our choice and decision. So these laws, which are like the framework of the creations that we make, we're making a heap of creations every single moment,
mm-hmm.
right? So it's now, how can we then say that the hells need a Satan to exist? They don't. All they need is for me to exercise my will in an evil manner. That's how they exist. There's no other way for them to exist.
Yeah. And the person was asking what sustains them. What sustains them is my will, isn't it?
Is my will. Yeah. My need for that place to exist because I created it through my will and my exercise of my will in an evil direction.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
That place now needs to exist while I need to live there.
Yeah.
If I no longer needed to live there, that place no longer needed to exist.
And this is the possibility, isn't it? As we were talking about the design feature, we can always choose to change our will.
Yes.
And therefore leave the hell that we had created.
Exactly. So these laws that God has made have created an infinite number of possibilities of existence, ranging from the most evil, which we would call the depths of the darkest hell,
yeah.
right the way through to the most bright, which is at the moment in the 36th dimension with the soul union state at this point. That could be infinite progression in that direction. Theoretically, it might also be infinite progression in the negative direction, yeah. theoretically, although in practice what happens is the pain of such suffering gets so intense that a person doesn't want to go further.
Yeah.
And so eventually they stop
yeah.
and they feel satisfied with the hell they've created.
And this is where I feel that God's nature shines through, doesn't it? Because and the way that she's created our universe in that it's all there designed to draw us closer to love and loving choices. But even in this giving us this free will, there's all these feedback mechanisms which actually prevent us going infinitely in the direction of darkness.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So it's very unlikely anybody would ever infinitely go in the direction of darkness. But I do feel quite strongly that there is the possibility of infinite progression in the direction of light, the direction of love. So that's the beautiful thing God has done. Corrective system created by our own soul through the structure of the universal laws that God has made and the beautiful gift of free will that God has given us to see and measure through our own feedback system where we are. And the system isn't based on our intellectual development. It's based completely on our passionate desires, whether they're exercised in harmony or out of harmony with love.
Mm.
And that's all that maintains the hells. The hells don't need to exist at all. If nobody ever exercised their will in the direction out of harmony with love, the hells would not exist. Right? But God had to create the potentiality of their existence. Otherwise, if we chose to do a negative thing, where we would live? So the potentiality of their existence had to be created through the law, and the possibility of their existence and the actuality of their existence is created through our own action, our own will. Exercise in a certain direction.
Mm-hmm.
So it's important that we understand this infinite number of possibilities and the effect that it actually has on the human soul and therefore the human soul choices, and then the infinite number of possibilities in terms of where we have to live as a result of those infinite possibilities of choices.
Sure.
Yep. The person in their question says that the people themselves would not be capable of doing it, in other words, referring to the creation of the hells, or would not be motivated to want to do it for obvious reasons. I cannot agree with that statement at all. I see people today motivated completely on destruction, motivated completely on doing evil acts.
Mm-hmm.
Like God, by giving us free will, made our soul extremely powerful, made us capable of creating heavens and hells. And a lot of people are completely wanting to create hells.
Yeah.
They do. They love living in the hells and they want to create the hells.
Yeah.
There are people on this planet and there are many millions and sometimes billions of them who want to create hellish conditions in which to live. They want a lack of morality. They want to be able to have the freedom to do any destructive thing they want to do. And, you know, his statement here, I feel, is like saying to a person who's drunk and who's drinking, saying to them that, oh, you wouldn't want to drink. Because look at all the negative things it creates.
Yeah.
How many people want to drink even knowing the negative things it creates in their own life? How many people drink and they see their life disintegrating around them? They see their relations disintegrating. They see their relationship with their children, their parents, their loved ones all disintegrating. They see their monetary issues going down the gurgler economically. They see their whole life being destroyed. They see how their life is being wrecked and yet they still have another drink.
Yeah.
So I cannot agree that people wouldn't want to create such places for themselves. Now, I feel this question is driven by a lack of understanding of people's desire for badness, which is all driven through fear and rage and rebellion. And the reasons for fear and rage and rebellion all are about suppressed emotional conditions, generally from childhood. So I feel that the person in this question doesn't really understand the psyche of man, the psyche of humankind.
Yeah.
In terms of what motivates our choices. So like many people have a huge motivation to create evil things in their lives.
Yeah.
And mostly it's rage and fear that determines these creations. But they have such a strong motivation that the only thing they can create is these things in their life. And you look at a person who, you know, is like Stalin and the people who supported him and Hitler and the people who supported him. Their primary motivations were towards destroying things in their life.
Yeah.
You know, and you can see that it must be driven by some pretty dark underlying emotions that they're in denial of to cause that particular thing to occur. So those kind of people have to create a hell in which to live, otherwise they have nowhere to live.
Mm.
Yeah. So, like in summary, I feel like God created this perfect framework in which all the possibilities of our choices based on our free will could be made. We could make hundreds of millions of different possibilities, and then he gave this option to all humankind. So the billions and billions of people of souls that he created all had ability to make completely different choices. Mm-hmm. So that means that there are billions and billions and billions of possibilities of locations in which a person can live. And God had to create a framework in which all of this could exist.
Yeah.
Very clever. Very clever if you think about it. Very clever.
And because you've just been talking about the hellish conditions that are created, but the converse is true. For every good decision, there's a corresponding place as well.
Yes.
And as we grow in love, the potentialities expand for that also.
Exactly.
As we refine our love. Yeah.
Exactly. So it's an incredible thing that God has created this beautiful ability to even develop your soul into a demonic state or to develop your soul into an angelic state and it be totally under your control, totally under the desire of your own will. Like that is an amazing gift that God has given us, this ability to make ourselves into anything we wish based on our will.
Yeah.
And I feel that once people understand this particular ability and the complexity of the framework of the laws that must exist in order for this ability to exist, then they will start understanding how powerful and great God is.
Yeah.
And how beautiful the system is.
And also, would you say also about really the power of God's creation in us, in that as a soul we are so geared towards creation.
Mm.
This person was saying we couldn't support the hells, but that's actually underestimating the power of the soul.
Yeah.
The soul, that's how much power we have in our soul to create.
We have the power to choose a heap of evil acts which finish up creating a location that is so destructive and terrible that even we ourselves can't live there.
Yeah.
and be happy.
And our external creation almost compels us to change.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly. It reflects back to us the need for our change.
Yeah.
That's how much power we have.
Yeah.
We also have the power to do the opposite of that. to create such angelic locations that we can't imagine the beauty of them. We also have that power. God has given us this power in either direction.
Yeah.
And this is a beautiful thing that God has done.
And just a beautiful gift that God has given us to sustain creation just through the use of our will.
Yes. Yeah. And if you consider that, then you can see that there is no need for a devil to even exist, because we sustain the location of existence through our desire to live in such a location. For our desire to be evil creates a location in which we can be evil.
Yeah.
Our desire to be good will create a location in which our desire to be good is met. It just depends on our desire. This is the beauty of our free will choices. Now, God has made it so that if you desire to be evil, you've got a very small location. So that location cannot largely impact upon every single other being in the universe.
Yes.
And God's made it that if you desire to be good, you have very large locations in which you can exist. And God has made it this way so that if you desire to be good, you can have a great impact on the rest of the world and rest of the existence and all the other people who exist.
Yeah.
Because you're acting in harmony with the principles of love that exist, that create the framework of the universe. And under such a framework, what need is there for a devil? There is no need for a devil. It's a perfect system.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't need some kind of flawed being who can't repent and who can't change and who can't get out of a point, can't be redeemed. And in fact, no such person can exist in this universe. The devil cannot exist in a perfect universe that God has created.
Mm-hmm.
Now, if I can conceive this perfect universe, then I'm very, very sure God can create it. So even my imagination conceiving it means that it's a probable part of creation.
Yeah.
And I'm saying it is also a certainty. I have observed this universe that I imagined at some point in my past did exist. I have now observed it in complete operation, so I can see its existence in complete operation, right from the depths of the hills, right the way through to what I have observed to be the pinnacle of mankind's current existence,
mm-hmm.
which I feel will improve even further after a time. So it's impossible for Satan the devil to exist in such a perfect system.
Because Satan himself would just be someone who had been making evil choices with his will, and he could change that at any time. And
exactly.
He would be, yeah.
And not only that, God has created this system which is redemptive. In
yes.
other words, the entire system has been created to redeem a person who makes a bad choice.
Mm-hmm.
Now, let's assume Satan is the worst of all people who have made all the bad choices that have ever been made.
Yeah.
He still has living in a universe that wants to redeem him.
Yes. So and geared to do
and
redeem.
Geared to redemption.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
So it's impossible for Satan to actually exist permanently.
Yeah.
Now, there are many devils. There are many people who are like worse than the average conception on the planet of what a Satan would be
mm-hmm.
because of their exercise of their will, but they are all able to be redeemed. There is no permanent fixed place for any of them.
Mm. Yep. It's good.
And there is no need for a Satan to maintain the evil. And in fact, the evil is just because of the choice of man. And it's a choice driven by fear. Underlying the choice.
Yeah.
It's the fear that generates the choice of rage and anger and rebellion and other emotions
yeah.
that cause the evil to exist. So I feel that the question, you know, has many other things that we need to raise with it too. There's another mm-hmm. few other points that I feel we need to point.
Yeah.
When the last living person in the lowest condition of the soul is redeemed,
mm-hmm.
then into a new condition, they only need to be redeemed from this point part here, which is the lowest of the hill, into this new condition here.
Yes.
Then there is no need for that condition to ever exist.
Well, in fact, doesn't it just simply cease to exist?
It just simply ceased to exist
yeah.
because it's no longer maintained by any soul that created it.
Yeah.
So this is the beautiful thing too, and this is foretold in the Bible, that the hills will be rolled up like a book scroll.
Mm.
Right? And the reason why this will occur is because as soon as these people that are in the hells currently get into a condition where they've been redeemed, into a new condition of love, there is no longer any need for this hell to exist because there's no one who needs to live there.
Yeah.
And once there's no one who needs to live there, it no longer needs to exist. It can disappear. There is not the soul maintaining its location anymore.
Mm-hmm.
This is how powerful our soul is. Our soul creates the locations and is able to destroy them depending upon what choices we make. And I'm talking now about destroying the locations in the hells. The hellish locations will eventually all be destroyed.
Not through any act of destruction, but just through the act of choosing to move our will in the direction of love.
And once the very last person moves their will,
disintegrate, won't they?
That's right. Once the very last person moves their will into the new condition, the hell will no longer exist because it no longer needs to exist.
Such an exciting prospect.
Yes, and that's one of the reasons why we've come, is to try and assist this process to happen a bit more rapidly than it's been happening in the past. The damage of the Bible teachings and holding on to the Christian teachings in themselves about the hells is that they tell the people that are in the hells that they can never get out of them. Now, if you consider this, it's a very damaging teaching, because what you're doing is you're telling a person they've created the hell, they're now living in the hell they've created, which is all true, but then you're telling them that they can't redeem themselves, that God hasn't made a perfect system that they could redeem themselves out of this condition. So you're telling them they can get in the condition, but they can't get out of it. Now, that is a very, very damaging teaching to tell somebody.
Yeah.
Because what you do is you then make them think, oh, if I can't get out of it, there's no point in trying.
Yeah.
And in some cases, it can make the person do even worse things because they feel that their life is hopeless.
Here I am. I'm stuck with this. I'm just going to do whatever I can to try and avoid this pain that I'm in, which usually is a fearful action, isn't it?
Yes.
So that usually means they take more and more damaging actions towards themselves and other people.
Exactly.
Whereas if they knew the truth, they could say, okay, here I am. This is telling me my will
is... This is where I am. I'm in the hells, but I can get out.
Yes.
If I exercise my will in a different direction, I can get out.
Yeah.
Now, you imagine the power of somebody being told that, rather than being told, once you're there, you're there for good. Now, a person who's told you're there for good usually goes into further rebellion.
Yeah.
And that causes their condition to even go even darker and create another deeper hell even. So often these Christian teachings have created even darker hells through the teaching. If we teach them instead that any person who gets to any location in the spirit world can get out of that location through the exercise of their will in a loving direction, now every single person has the potential of getting out of their condition.
Mm-hmm.
And that's a beautiful, loving creation. Yeah. So there are many other reasons why Satan can't logically exist. But as I've explained through this answer, there's quite a lot of logical reasons we've already presented as to why Satan cannot exist, why the hells do not need Satan to exist, why a loving God would have created the potentiality of the hells existing, and so forth.
Yeah.
So I feel that we've answered fairly comprehensively the person's question about the possibilities of the hell's existence, and also given in the answer the possibility of the hell's not being a future requirement, depending on how mankind generally exercises their will.
Yeah.
So this is a beautiful...
It's a hope for the future, isn't it?
Exactly.
Yeah.
The hell's only need to exist why the human chooses unloving actions.
Mm.
The hell's no longer need to exist once the human stopped choosing unloving actions. So the humans maintain the hell.
Yeah.
And there's no need for any other creature to maintain them. And there is, in fact, no other creature that does maintain the hells.
Mm. Mm. Great discussion. Thank you. Babe. So this question is from a Christian lady.
Mm-hmm.
She says, as a Christian, I believe that God desires fellowship with us, but that he cannot be present with anything dark or imperfect. She takes this belief from 1 John chapter 1, verse 5.
Which says, this is the message we have heard from him and declare to you, God is light and in him there is no darkness at all.
So in order to have fellowship with us, he must have atonement for man's sin.
So in other words, we're all dark, he's light, he can't fellowship with us, and he needs some kind of intermediary to ensure fellowship with us.
I see. Okay. We believe that he sent down Jesus to be the sacrifice so that he would be able to abide with us eternally if we will accept the gift, the free gift he offers us.
Which is Jesus' blood sacrifice, the atonement, what they call the atonement sacrifice.
I see. It's a free will choice. under this model, God does not send people to hell and he is not a punishing God.
Mm.
People who have had near-death experiences have lived to tell of a God that weeps over the lost who end up going to hell, i.e. he feels sad about them going to hell but cannot interfere with anyone's free will.
Interesting concept of God, yes.
So, if I take all these beliefs away,
mm-hmm.
how do I know that God loves me? I can't seem to take it any further than God desires me to have divine love and truth, and that I can be at one with him someday. And then I can be at one with him someday. But what's God's reason for this?
Yep. Go on, is there more to the question?
There is. And I feel this person is very sincere.
Very sincere, I agree.
Very sincere.
Very sincere. So, and I'm not laughing at the person. I'm more laughing at the reasoning that's occurring within the person to come up with these ideas or concepts, which we'll talk about as we go through.
That would be good, yeah. So back to the question, what's God's reason for wanting us to have divine love and divine truth and becoming at one with him?
Mm-hmm.
It could be love, or it could be for the good of mankind and mankind's existence,
mm-hmm.
or it could be many other things. Please let me know what you feel I am missing.
Wow. Well,
so could we understand the question well? Because for me, there's a
what,
lot
what
there.
What the lady is saying, I'm assuming it's a lady.
It is a lady, yeah.
So what the lady is saying is that, firstly, she believes that God cannot be present with anything that's imperfect, and because mankind is imperfect, that God cannot be present with us without mm-hmm. there being some intermediary.
Mm-hmm.
And the intermediary that God created was Jesus, the sacrifice of atonement so that he could abide with us. So, mm-hmm. in other words, God's reliant on the blood of Jesus, so it's not only us humans that are reliant on the blood of Jesus, but God's reliant on the blood of Jesus in order to have a relationship with humans.
I see. Okay.
And this sacrifice is believed to be a loving sacrifice. It's an expression, God gave his only son as a sacrifice, and that proves God's love to us.
I see.
Like saying that you have to prove your love to me by sacrificing your daughter or son.
Yeah.
And then I'll know that you love me.
And so that's why in the second part of the question she asks, how do I know that God loves me?
If there's no sacrifice, how do I know God loves me?
I see.
Because if God hasn't sacrificed his only son in order to prove that he loves me, how do I know God loves me?
Mm-hmm.
It's almost saying, the question itself is almost saying that to prove that you love somebody, you have to kill your own son.
Or at least have some kind of sacrifice.
Well, no, it's saying specifically that you have to kill your own beloved son to prove how much you love the other person.
Yeah, right.
Now, that's not very fair for the son, for a start, if you think about it logically. But it's basically saying that if I had a son and you wanted proof that I loved you, the way I could prove that I loved you was by killing my son for you, and then I could prove that I love you. Now, that concept is a pretty flawed concept in terms of love.
Mm.
It's basically saying that you would expect me to kill my own son in order to prove that I love you.
Mm-hmm.
Why can't I just love you and my own son and not kill any of you?
Yeah.
Why can't I do that? Because you won't accept it. So this is about mankind's inability to accept love that isn't based around sacrifice.
I see.
Do you see?
Yes.
The question itself is flawed because it assumes that love needs sacrifice in order to be love.
Mm-hmm.
And that is a very, very flawed concept of love.
Yeah.
And so this is a flawed concept of love that most Christians believe, or many Christians believe, that proof of somebody loving you is for them to destroy something that they love to prove to you that they love you.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I would ask, why do you need such terrible proof that somebody loves you? Surely that's a very destructive thing to get proof of. And also, if you think about it, nobody in their right mind would get married and as a proof of their love for their marriage partner kill their only child.
Mm.
No one in their right mind would do that. But that's what Christians are suggesting God is doing.
Yeah.
Which... is a pretty damaging concept about God. Yeah. This is why I have to laugh, because there are so many damaging concepts about God in this underlying belief system.
So there's that belief, but then there's this idea of asking, okay, God desires me to have divine love and truth, but what's God's reason for this?
And why couldn't it be just love?
Yeah, okay.
can you see how for this kind of person, they don't believe love is possible without sacrifice. Mm. That's where they're coming from.
I see.
And they're basically stating that unless God sacrifices something that he finds precious, that people on earth will not believe that God loves them. Now, that is a very flawed concept about love, if you think about it. So there is many parts to this question that I would like to address. There's probably four or five parts to the question.
Yep.
That is one of the parts that I'll address, like this flawed concept of what is required to demonstrate or prove love is a terrible, it's a terrible requirement that Christians are placing upon God. They're basically wanting God to sacrifice his only son as proof that God loves them. And yet, if they had their own son, and somebody came along and said, look, you prove you love me, kill your son, would they agree? They would tell them to go to hell, probably.
Well, isn't there an account of God asking someone to do this in the Bible?
This is part of the problem. There is this account with Isaac in the Bible, with Abraham and Isaac, and Isaac, you know, requiring the being the sacrifice that God required. So Abraham, according to this story, God required Abraham to attempt to sacrifice Isaac in order to prove Abraham's obedience to God.
Mm.
Now, I would suggest to you that any God that requires you to murder your own son is not a very loving God. And this is where the concept of God sacrificing for God came from in the Jewish faith.
Mm-hmm.
So you have to see that it surely is a very unloving concept of God. It's a concept of an unloving God is probably the better way to put it, which does not exist, actually. This God does not exist. But it has many humans in the past, way before Abraham's time, believed in this kind of a God. They believed in this wrathful, angry God who demanded sacrifice. And they used to sacrifice their firstborn children, and usually virgin women, to the gods in order to appease them. And there are even accounts in the pageant messages where you see these spirits who had these belief systems. Now, Abraham came from that same time period, so he had a very similar belief system of God until it changed, and he started to realize that, no, God didn't want a sacrifice of my child. And all he did then was sacrifice an animal instead. So he still thought that God required blood, which doesn't make any sense either, because God created the blood in that animal. So how would it ever appease God? It already belongs to God.
Yeah.
And very few people consider that. But this whole concept of sacrifice being proof of love is a very damaging concept to a person's concept of God, but also to a person's concept of love. It's suggesting that the only way to prove that you love somebody is by sacrificing something that you find precious for them.
Mm.
And this is a very flawed concept of love. It's very prevalent on the earth. But very flawed concept about love. And, there's a lot that we need to say about this, so let's get started.
Okay.
Firstly, the question in 1 John 1 verse 5, it suggests, of course, the suggestion that God cannot have anything to do with darkness. There is no darkness in God. Now, just because there is no darkness in God, it doesn't mean that God can't have anything to do with darkness.
Mm.
In the sense that God can't interact with people in darkness. In the Bible, there are other locations in the Bible that talk about Satan the devil, who we've already discussed does not exist, being in God's company. Now, that would suggest that God can interact with people who are in darkness. So it's not accurate to state that God cannot interact with people who are in darkness. Now, this woman is suggesting that in order to fellowship with us, he must have atonement for man's sin. However, in the Bible record in Job, God did not require atonement for Satan's sin. And under the Christian definition, Satan's sin is the worst possible sin that anyone has ever committed. Mm-hmm. And yet God could converse with Satan directly.
Mm-hmm.
Now, if God can converse with Satan directly, surely God can converse with any other person who's a sinner directly. Right? So it's totally illogical from the teachings of the Bible itself to believe that God cannot spend time with sinners. Also, if we examine it from another perspective, and that is this. Most Christians believe that Jesus is God. And yet in the Bible it says quite categorically that Jesus spent time with sinners. Now, if Jesus was God and Jesus spent time with sinners, then it means God can spend time with sinners.
Yeah.
And this happened before Jesus gave the sacrifice.
Yeah.
So therefore it didn't need Jesus' sacrifice in order for Jesus, God, to spend time with sinners. So again, it makes no logical sense, this reasoning. So if we examine some of the Bible verses that talk about that, in Luke 7, it talks about the woman who was a sinner who washed Jesus' feet. So she touched Jesus. She touched God, according to the Christians.
Yeah.
And yet that was allowed, and Jesus interacted with this woman, right, with freedom, and therefore proving that God could interact with people before Jesus atoned, before the death of Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
Now, if God could do it before the death of Jesus and God did it after the death of Jesus, then what was the point of the death of Jesus? Well, there was no point. The death of Jesus did not create what these people assume, which is the atonement of sin, because the reality is before Jesus' death, God could reside with badness. God could speak with people who were bad. That didn't mean God was bad. He could just speak with them, right? And God did speak with them according to the Bible. And then Jesus, when he was on earth before he died, he spoke with people who were bad, which means that there was no need for Jesus to sacrifice himself in order to speak with people, for God to be with people that were bad.
Mm-hmm.
So the presumption here that she says in her question, so in order to have fellowship with us, God must have atonement for man's sin, is incorrect.
Mm-hmm.
God does not need atonement with man's sin in order to fellowship with sinners. Just because God fellowships with sinners, it doesn't make God a sinner. There's verses in the Bible that state this interestingly enough. Like, here's one. In Matthew 11, for example, it says in 18 and 19, for John came neither eating nor drinking, and they say, he has a demon. The Son of Man came eating and drinking, and they say, here is a glutton and a drunkard, a friend of tax collectors and sinners. So here it's saying in the Bible itself that Jesus was a friend of tax collectors and sinners. Now, if Jesus was God, then God was a friend of tax collectors and sinners, and God did not need Jesus' sacrifice in order to be a friend of tax collectors and sinners. Mm.
So basically you're showing that the Christian belief system is flawed. If they believe in the atonement and believe in the scripture, they actually contradict each other.
Exactly. They're totally contradictory to each other.
Mm-hmm.
By believing in one, you contradict the other.
Mm-hmm.
And so this is where, like, I find many contradictions in the Christian belief systems. There are more contradictions in the Christian belief system than there is in the Bible itself. Because if a person actually believes what the Bible says, there would not be as many contradictions. But there are more contradictions in the Christian belief system than the Bible itself contains. Now, in John 4, verse 6 and 7, this is what it says. It says that, just get it.
14,
sorry, that's right. Yeah, looking at the wrong thing. 14, 6 and 7, it says, Jesus answered, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you really knew me, you would know my Father as well. From now on, you do know him and have seen him. So what I was saying there, and I did say those words, is that because I was at one with God, every action that I took was the kind of action that my Father would take.
Yeah.
Everything that I did was the kind of thing my Father would do. This was while I was alive. These things were what I would do and what my Father would do while I was alive. Now, if I sat down and let my feet be washed by a sinner, I can certainly have association with darkness.
Yeah.
It doesn't mean that I am dark. It means that I am interacting with a person who may be in different condition. Now, if we take that verse to be literal, and many, most Christians do, then that means then that I showed what God was like.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I'm showing what God was like. In showing what God was like, I was demonstrating that God could interact with sinners just as I could interact with sinners before my death.
And you're also correcting the, you're also saying that the Christian belief is that you were God, and if you follow that doctrine, then it's demonstrated that you, that God can be with sinners.
Because my actions were, I was with sinners, yes.
But you and I know the truth that you weren't God.
No.
You, but you were at one with God, so you mirrored his feelings and beliefs and
desires. So no matter what thing you believe about what my nature or character was,
you still spent time with sinners.
And therefore God could spend time with sinners.
Yes.
So therefore God did not need any atonement sacrifice in order to spend time with sinners.
Mm-hmm.
Right. So I'm using the logic from the Bible here. Of course, I feel the Bible is flawed. But even using its own logic, God could spend time with sinners before Jesus died.
Yes.
And if God could do that before Jesus died and God could do that after Jesus died, what was the point of Jesus' death? None. Nothing. Mm-hmm. No, nothing whatsoever. And that is true. The truth is I didn't die for any atonement reason.
Yeah.
That is an underlying truth.
Yeah.
So according to, so if I am truly God and I spent time with sinners on earth, then it's possible for a person who's in a condition of light to spend time in darkness mm-hmm. without being affected by the darkness.
Mm-hmm.
And that is true.
Mm-hmm.
That is a very basic understanding and a very basic truth that we need to understand. We can be surrounded by darkness and still be light.
And
ourselves.
Isn't inherent in this question the implication that God is our parent who is perfect, but by implication in the statement it's saying that the parent, the perfect parent, can somehow be affected or restricted from communing with the imperfect child.
Exactly.
And
it's a ludicrous proposition if you think about it.
Yeah.
Like it's basically saying that a person who is the most powerful person in the universe is restricted by his own laws to interacting with a person who has decided to walk away from him.
Mm.
And it's not true. How can it be true? Now, the reverse could be true. The person who's walked away from God is now restricted from having a relationship with God, but not through any choice of God, but rather through the choice of the individual. Very, very different. Very different. You see, it's almost like Christians want to blame God for the sacrifice, the atonement sacrifice. It's a very warped concept that is not based on any logical discussion whatsoever, but also is based upon a lot of very harmful beliefs about God. It's based on a lot of like very harmful projections towards God. And I'm not saying that they harm God, they harm the individual because they believe God to be this person. When how could God ever be such a person? If you had almighty power of the universe, who are you restricted from talking to in this universe? The answer is no one. No one, no matter what their choices and decision, you can still commune with them.
Yeah.
Whether they can commune with you is a different matter altogether based on their condition.
Yeah.
But you would be able to commune with them. God has unlimited and unrestricted power, even with God's laws, and God can commune with any person, whether they're, you know, sinner or not a sinner, doesn't matter. God can commune, spend time with us in any state if we're open to such communication, if we're open to such, a relationship. No matter what state we're in, we can be open to such relationship and God will engage the relationship. So, you know, also in the Old Testament of the Bible, it's suggested that different people spent time with God. Now, under the Christian belief structure, that would not be possible.
Mm.
But in the Old Testament, it suggests that people did spend time with God. So which is it that's true? Again, the logic is flawed.
Sure.
So we need to understand this basic problem with this logic, this concept that God needs an atonement of sin in order to commune with people is a flawed concept. Based from very, very old concepts about God of being a punishing, wrathful God, needing sacrifice in order, needing blood, really, in order to communicate and to favour humankind. And it's based around fear, huge amounts of fear, in fact, this concept of God. And we would never consider that an individual who sacrifices his own child needed to do so in order to prove his love to us. And yet, we do almost demand of God that he sacrifice Jesus, his own beloved child, according to our belief systems, to in order for us to have a relationship with God. And it's a very flawed concept. And it's flawed on a number of areas. Why did Jesus deserve the sacrifice? Why did he deserve that treatment? He doesn't deserve that treatment. What about him? What about his feelings in the matter?
Yeah.
Now, a lot of people then say, oh, but he was a part of God and all that. But that's not true. But even if he was a part of God, it makes no sense at all. If he was a part of God, then God already had it.
Yes.
Why does God need to do something that creates a lot of pain when God already had what he was wanting to do?
Yeah.
Again, it makes no sense whatsoever.
Yeah.
So this flawed concept of the atonement sacrifice, the blood sacrifice, the vicarious sacrifice, causing and allowing a relationship between God and mankind, it is so flawed on so many levels, logically and from a loving perspective, that it's amazing, I believe, that people can even believe it. Now, interestingly enough, in my own life, in this life, due to some history of my, I did believe it for a period of time.
Mm.
And I go, wow, how flawed was my concept of love? Once I gave up this concept of love, that love requires sacrifice, I could not accept it after that point. Could not accept it. And I suggest that most Christians will not be able to accept it once they have a different viewpoint of love. So that's the first point I'd like to make.
Sure.
If people could receive God's love before Jesus died and people could receive God's love after Jesus died, then it demonstrates that Jesus' death had no change.
Impact.
Now, the reality is people could not receive God's love before Jesus came, not before he died. So before I came to the earth, people could not receive divine love because they didn't know how. They didn't know how to. And in my discovery of how to, they also could be taught how to receive God's love. That's the point of my life. The point of my life was to demonstrate to people how to receive God's love.
Yeah.
It was my life, not my death, that was important to a Christian or any person, in fact, who wanted to have a relationship with God.
Say it again, baby.
It was my life,
yes.
Not my death. It was by listening to the truths that I discovered through my life and my demonstrating that truth through my own example that allowed a Christian then to come to the knowledge that they too could have the same relationship with God.
Yeah.
Not my death. My death created nothing except pain for you and my child, pain for a lot of my so-called disciples at the time. It created no other benefit except one, and that was that I could demonstrate to my disciples that there was no such thing as death by reappearing to them after I died.
Yeah.
That's the only benefit that it gave.
Yeah.
No other benefit was created through my death. The second part of the question suggests that God needs the sacrifice in order to be eternally abide with people on earth. So she's saying here, he would be able to abide with us eternally as long as the sacrifice of Jesus was applied.
Mm.
Now, my suggestion to people is God abides eternally under all conditions. Whether he is with us is completely dependent upon the exercise of our individual will for God to be with us. Nothing else. It's not dependent upon a third party sacrifice. My sacrifice was of no benefit to anybody requiring a relationship with God. My discovery of the divine truth was of immense benefit to everybody who wanted a relationship with God.
Mm-hmm.
It was the discovery and application of divine truth and then my desire to share that with others through my personal example and my life that caused people to have the possibility of having a relationship with God. It had nothing to do with my death. Nothing whatsoever. And any person who considers that it did is not being reflective about even the Bible record itself, because the Bible record shows that I, a human, had a relationship with God before I died.
Yeah.
Now, if I could have a relationship with God before I died and I am a human, it means that you as a human also could have a relationship with God before I died. I was encouraging every single person I was teaching at the time to have a relationship with God before I died.
And many of us did and have many, that relationship.
Many did. Yeah. Yeah, many begun the relationship with God before I died. Yeah. I would never have encouraged that. I would have said otherwise. I would have said, wait till I die and then you can have a relationship with God.
Yeah.
Now, the Bible indicates itself that I never said to anybody, wait till I die and then you'll be able to have a relationship with God.
Yeah.
I said, do what I do while I'm alive and you'll have a relationship with God. And that's very plain in the Bible. So the whole logic of the atonement sacrifice is all in, it's very flawed. And I do not understand why Christians hold on to it so dearly.
I feel it's very emotional for people.
It is very emotional.
This idea of someone giving up their life just for me, as this lady expresses in her question, is very emotional for people. They think, wow, what bigger gift could I be given and what...
Well, it's true. The reality is if I decided through a choice of mine to give up my life so you could live, then that's a wonderful benefit. So emotionally, I can see why people feel very open to the belief, but God doesn't require such a thing in order for you to have a relationship with God. Now, and in fact, my death under these circumstances can only occur at the hands of people who are very damaged themselves. Like, why would anyone want to kill you, let alone kill me in place of you?
Yeah.
Like, it makes no sense for anybody who actually loves to want to kill anybody.
Yeah.
So my suggestion is the whole concept of sacrificing life comes from humanity's long history of death and terrible pain occurring throughout history, and then people standing up and dying for the sake of others.
Yeah.
It comes not from my own actions.
Yeah.
Right? Now, the reality is I did stand up for truth and I died for my standing up for truth. I didn't die for the sake of any person. Yeah. I died because I did not wish to compromise truth in my life. That's why I died. Now, people want to believe that I died for them because they want to have that feeling that, oh, someone loves me so much that they died for me. Yeah. That's the only reason why they want to believe it.
Yeah.
But to attribute this death to God is ludicrous. In a lot of ways, it's so ludicrous, it's amazing, really, because in a way, it's almost stating that the people who killed me were necessary for God.
Yeah.
You see, it's almost saying, like, God can't kill himself. So there's this assumption that Jesus is God, too, and God can't kill himself because that would be suicide. So that's not on.
Right? Yes.
So then someone has to kill him for the sacrifice to occur.
Yes.
So then Pilate, Herod, and the Roman soldiers all become a part of the sacrifice occurring. So why aren't they all blessed instead of condemned?
Saints.
Because they should all be saints under this construct, because they all were a necessary part of Jesus' death.
Yeah.
Without them, Jesus' death couldn't have occurred. So they should all be accredited for the so-called atonement sacrifice as well, if you think about it.
Yeah. But it wasn't possible without
them. It wasn't possible without them.
Yeah.
So, you know, and obviously such a concept is ludicrous, right?
Yeah.
So there's another reason why such a concept is flawed. The third part of the question suggests that God grieves over the condition of humankind. The questioner states, people who have had near-death experience have lived to tell that God weeps over the lost who end up going to hell. That is, he feels sad about them going to hell but cannot interfere with anyone's will. This whole concept that God is sad is flawed. God is not sad. How could God be sad about a perfect universe that God created operating in a perfect manner because of his perfect laws? Such a concept that God would create his own sadness by creating a whole heap of flawed laws that then God would have to obey himself is crazy, let alone unreasonable. It's definitely not true. No one in the spirit world who has had a near-death experience and visited spirit world has ever seen God cry.
Mm.
They've seen spirits who claim to be God crying.
Yeah.
They've seen spirits
claiming to be you.
Who claim to be me crying. Yeah. They've also seen spirits who want to show that God cries, impersonating a crying God, just so the person on earth feels like they're loved because they're cared for and that they're going to cause God pain if they choose something that's out of harmony with God's laws.
Mm-hmm.
You do not cause God any pain when you choose to do something out of harmony with God's laws. None whatsoever. God smiles at your decision. God realizes and has compassion over the fact that you create your own pain, but God does not cry at the decision you willingly make in order to disobey God's laws and principles.
Is this another idea of love being shown through sadness and regret?
Of course it is.
So yeah. Obviously there's a lot of, and I know that there's accounts in the Bible where you supposedly wept and people see that as a sign of your love.
There's only one time that I remember weeping in the first century, and that was when Lazarus was said to be dead and they had buried my friend alive.
Yeah.
Now, I was pretty sad about that because I was thinking, wow, they don't understand so much about death that they can go and bury my friend and he's alive. You imagine being bound from head to toe, wrapped up so you cannot move, and you're alive and you're in that condition for over 2 days.
Yeah.
Right? Now, the Bible account that he was smelling was not true. He was not smelling, right? But he was constrained in this place being alive. Right, and in this place where he hadn't died yet, it's sort of like a place before the spirit body has left the material body.
Yeah.
And I knew my friend had been buried alive, and my sadness was caused by the fact that people would go ahead and bury him alive because they didn't understand death at all.
Mm-hmm.
And so naturally, I let myself have a cry about that and went and remedied the situation.
Sure.
And the accounts that he smelled and all those kind of things were not true. They were later embellishments to prove that I somehow had resurrected from the dead, which I did not do because it's impossible.
Yeah.
But they, again, they are things that people feel, you know, a weeping God appeals to their emotional state.
Mm-hmm.
And God doesn't weep. God's a happy God. If God wept, I don't know what the results would be in the universe, but they'd be pretty really? Incredibly intense, I would have thought. If God wept over sinners, then due to the number of sinners that are on the planet and in the spirit world, God would be weeping a lot.
Yeah.
Because there are billions of sinners and billions of people on earth and in the spirit world who are directly doing things in disharmony with God's laws and love.
Mm.
And if God was a sad God, imagine how much crying he'd be doing. It's like you having a billion friends and you have to cry about each one of them.
Yeah.
Or 20 billion friends and have to cry about each one of them. Imagine the immensity of the grief.
Yeah.
God is not like this at all.
Well, and as we've discussed in other questions, God's actually designed inherent in his laws ways that we're going to come back to love and understand our will anyway, aren't we? So would be his cause for sadness?
Mm.
Nothing is permanent.
There is no cause for sadness because God created a perfect system. You're not sad about a perfect system that you create. And God is never sad about the beautiful system God created. God looks at it with marvel and thinks, wow, aren't I a fantastic creator? God looks at it, and my feelings are that God looks at it and goes, wow, this is a beautiful system that I've made.
Mm-hmm.
And I would love for the people in this system to come to understand how beautiful it is, which the people who develop in love do eventually come to see
mm-hmm.
how beautiful the system is. It's a remarkable system that God's created. And God would never need to cry about anything that's happening in the system. And God doesn't cry about anything that's happening in the system. And once you become at one with God, you don't cry about anything that's happening in the system either. That's the reality. You may have compassion and express compassion through tears, and you may have joy and you cry in your joy, but you don't cry in sadness,
mm-hmm.
you know, and you might have some frustration still, even once you're at one with God, in the sense of seeing how everybody acts and behaves. And when I say frustration, it's not anger or anything, it's just frustration in the sense of, wow, if only everyone could see it differently,
yeah.
then that everything would be different. But, you know, the reality is there is no pain in God.
Mm.
Pain is a human creation based upon our fear and our walking away from God. If we believe there is pain in God, we have a very incorrect concept of God. God is not pained by anything that we do, but God wishes and hopes and has compassion for our condition and hopes and wishes that we change, hopes and wishes that we get into a better condition. But also God has created this beautiful universe that we've got no other future other than getting into a better condition.
Thank goodness.
Thank goodness for that. So this concept that God is a sad God is a very damaging concept of God. Now, the question also said that if we take away all these beliefs because they're illogical and unnecessary, as we've discussed, and contradictory, then we're left with the primary question, and that is, how do we know that God loves us? And basically it's a statement that it's impossible to know God loves us unless God sacrifices for us.
That's the questioner's belief system.
Yeah, that's the questioner's belief system.
Yeah.
But how do you know someone loves you in an interaction? How do you know? Well, they give love to you and you feel it. Mm-hmm. That's how you know.
Yeah.
There's no other way of knowing. You receive it and then you receive the expressions of love that they give you. Mm-hmm. And that's how you know. Now, would you view an expression of love if I said, I'm going to show you I love you, and then I slaughter my son? Would you see that as an expression of love?
No.
Or would you be totally freaked out?
Yes.
Wouldn't you be totally freaked out and scared of the person? Wow, if they could do that to their own son and say, this is love, what can they do to me?
Yeah.
You'd be pretty scared, wouldn't you?
Yeah, definitely.
So, and this is what I'm suggesting, is that since God is perfect and God always has his love available to give to a person, he doesn't need to go and slaughter anybody in order to prove his love. He just continues to give his love. And when the person desires to receive it, their heart becomes open and they receive it and then they know. But only then do they know. Mm-hmm. They won't know in any other way. They won't know by some sacrifice. In fact, they'll be freaked out by a sacrifice, just as you would be freaked out if I decided to kill my own son in order to prove I loved you. You'd be very frightened of me after that, I'm very sure.
Yeah.
Right? And this is why a lot of people are frightened of God. If God can kill his own son in order to prove his love for me, what can he do to me?
Yeah.
In order to prove his love for somebody else.
Yeah.
Right? So again, the whole concept is flawed from a love perspective. Now, the love of God can't enter the person unless the person desires the love to enter. The person has to exercise their free will in order for the love to enter. So if you love me and I go, well, I don't want it, then your love will never enter me or change me or have an effect on me. And it's the same with my relationship with God. If God wants to love me and I go, I don't want it, stay away from me, then of course God's love cannot enter me and therefore I will not have a loving relationship with God. It's as simple as that. It's my choice. And it's very much the same. The only way that you know whether God loves you is when you're open to receiving love from God and you actually receive it. Mm-hmm. That's the only way you're going to know. And what it tells me, these sacrifice beliefs, it tells me that they've received very little of God's love. Mm. Because if they'd received more of God's love, they'd know that God is not capable of such things. God is not capable of the sacrifice of a beloved son in order to prove love to another beloved son. God's not capable of such a choice. And as a result, once I've received enough love of God to know that, I would never believe in the belief.
Is this why some Christians then start to begin to focus on your life on earth, mm-hmm. rather and the idea of the sacrifice seems to be put a bit to the side or the back burner in terms of their faith?
If we're honest about it, what we can see is the average Christian would have a huge amount of conundrums with regard to the blood sacrifice principle as being expression of love. Mm. And they feel these conundrums in their soul. And so what they try to do then is they try to avoid the discussion of it. They want to militantly believe it, mm-hmm. as because of the emotional reasons that we've previously discussed. But their own soul doesn't sit well with it. Once they receive some divine love, their own soul does not sit well with the belief. And so what they do then is they try to distance themselves from the belief to an extent and then focus on the love that I demonstrated in my day-to-day life that they could see reflected in the Bible through the first century accounts.
Yeah.
And what they do then is they try to imitate the love that I had. Now, that is certainly a far better direction to take, in my opinion. Yeah. If you imitate the love that I had while I was alive, then you would do well in your life. However, if you understand that God's love transformed me to the point where I could love in that way, then you'll find it much easier than a hard job to do.
Sure.
So many Christians find it very hard to imitate me because they have all these unloving emotions inside of them that keep rearing their heads occasionally. And they, it's only by the reception of divine love that these unloving emotions will disappear.
Mm-hmm.
And if they understood that, they would find love a lot easier to both understand and practice in their day-to-day life. So for these reasons, I feel that, you know, the question is like flawed on so many issues.
Yeah.
And it shows the flaw in the belief system. Does that make sense?
Yes.
But also it's... it comes from a basic understanding that God doesn't really love them until God sacrifices for them, and then God loves them. And you can see that if we applied such principles to our love for our, you know, for a partner, there'd be children dying everywhere.
Yeah,
it'd be a terrible world. It'd be a very fear-inspiring world too for all the children who were constantly having their life threatened, trying to prove, with their parents trying to prove to each other that they love each other. It's a terrible concept if you put it into a practical application on earth. And I've suggested to people who are Christian or not that any time it's a terrible concept to consider for us, it's a much worse concept to consider for God, because God is far better than any of us.
Hmm.
God is far more loving than any of us.
Mm.
So, yeah, the concepts are very, very flawed. The person in conclusion asks, what am I missing? Well, as I've explained, the person is missing a lot of things.
Yeah.
They're firstly missing a personal relationship with God, because if they had this personal relationship with God that was based on love only, they would understand that sacrifice is not necessary for love to exist. So that's one thing they're missing. They're also missing an accurate concept of God. They believe God to be much worse than God actually is. They believe God to be worse than even the average person on earth in terms of his behaviour. And no wonder they're frightened of God if they believe God to be like this. In addition, they're not recognizing within themselves, they're missing the emotions that drive them to being attracted to such a belief.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a whole group of emotions, you know, this idea and concept that if someone sacrifices for me, they prove their love for me. Now, how many times in a day-to-day relationship do they want their husband to sacrifice for them to prove that he loves her, instead of want their husband to do what he desires, and if he desires to love her, he will show her the love that he has,
yeah,
not through sacrifice, but through demonstration of other things. They demonstrate that these concepts that they're trying to understand with their mind even don't exist in their own soul. They also demonstrate they're missing logic. They're missing logical analysis of these Bible verses, going, well, if I believe that from that verse and I believe that from that verse, these two are contrary beliefs that I'm believing. How can I marry these two contrary beliefs up and make them into a third thing where both of them are true?
Yeah.
It's a totally illogical thing to attempt such an argumentation. And this is one reason why Christians resort generally to anger when they're arguing, because and personal attack when they're arguing, because their actual arguments are often flawed with logic. And because the logic is flawed, they have to now revert to personal attack and condemnation of the individual by telling them they're going to go to hell, rather than listening to the particular reasoning that a person has. So I feel she's missing that as well. I feel she's missing also the true definition of love.
This is what I wanted to ask
she's
you about.
She's missing this,
yes,
big thing.
It seems like many people on earth have married this idea of sacrifice, even if they're not Christians.
Yes.
This idea of sacrifice and love being,
yes,
synonymous.
They've joined them together, like, and they're not.
And how do people move beyond that? Because that's entered them as an emotional belief. They see sacrifice as a sign of love.
Yep.
So they don't feel loved if someone's not sacrificing for them.
Yep. How many women feel that in a relationship? When the man doesn't sacrifice for them, I'm not loved anymore.
And so many of us were told by our parents, you know, I'm sacrificing this for you because I love you. And as children, we learn I should sacrifice my desires for the...
And that's the point. The point is we imbibe these teachings about God because we've had them forced upon us by our parents.
Mm-hmm.
We've had our parents tell us while they're building us, while we're experiencing pain and while they're being violent, that they're being loving. We've had our parents tell us that they're sacrificing their life for us and that's an expression of their love for us. None of it is true. None of it is true. It is, but it unfortunately colours our beliefs about love. And once our beliefs about love are coloured, we then accept religious beliefs that are also coloured by the same tainted love. You know that song? Tainted love, tainted love. You know, don't touch me, please. I cannot stand the way. You know, like he was saying in this song, there's all these things that love does that people, the average person says love does, but he could see it's all tainted. It's all wrong. And what we need to do in order to get rid of these belief systems inside of ourselves is to actually start to see that these versions of love are tainted. They're not love at all.
So we begin to see that with our intellect.
We need to see that with our intellect, then grieve the fact that we've been taught it like as a condition of love.
And is it true that if we connect to our childhood experience where these things were done or we were told these things, if we really connect to our feelings of those times,
we'll have a lot of grief.
We'll find grief and not a sense of being loved.
No.
And so as soon as we do that, that opens us up to receiving a new
truth. Average child, when it's being smacked and being told that it's being loved, doesn't feel it's being loved at the time.
Yeah.
Like it feels it must believe the parent, but it doesn't feel it's being loved.
Yeah.
It needs to go back to that time and realise that the building was violent and an assault on them, a physical assault that was very, very damaging to them psychologically and emotionally.
Yeah.
And once they allow themselves to feel that, they'll grieve that and they'll forgive their parent for their actions. And they'll also end up with this beautiful result, which is I'll no longer believe that love is sacrifice.
Yeah.
I'll no longer believe that love is violent.
Yeah.
I'll no longer believe that love is punishing. And this is the underlying problem with what the Bible teaches. It teaches these things because the average person on this planet believes such things. And they are open to believing such things because the average person on this planet has had a parent who has taught them these things. So we need to understand the relationship of belief and how things are created. And it's something that we're going to discuss in some discussions in the future, is this relationship between why a person accepts a certain belief and what emotions in them cause them to accept this belief that's obviously out of harmony of love when you look at it from the point of logic and also from a point of feeling.
Yes.
Like, you know, any person who feels would sense that if I sacrificed my son to prove that I love you, that I'm not being loving to my son and I'm not being loving to you and I'm freaking the hell out of anybody around me, right? The average person would see that. So why don't they see it with God? Because they've been taught this all their life and they taught to come to believe it, and they sort of, for some reason, believe that God gets away with things that the average person on earth would find destructive and very damaging.
Yeah.
And it's not true. God is better than any person on this earth and planet. And I feel with what we've discussed today in these FAQs, if we could come to terms with that one fact, that God is love and God is not angry, God is not punishing, God does not need sacrifice, God does not need you to, you know, have some self-flagellation in order to prove that you love God. God feels love for you. And the only reason why you don't feel it is because your heart is not open to feeling it. And if we come to that conclusion, we would look at all the reasons why our heart is not open rather than seeking for a God who is an unloving God. The God that you seek is the person you become. If you seek an unloving God, you are going to become an unloving person. And at some point in your future, you will need correction. And this is why many Christians pass into the spirit world with a lot of correction needing to occur, because they've come to believe in an unloving God. And therefore, they've become unloving themselves as a result. You see many people of a religious nature on this planet acting violently in order to support their religious faith, because they justify their violence by saying their God is violent. Their God is not violent. Their God of their own imagination is violent. The real God who actually exists is not violent, is always loving, is always compassionate, always kind, always merciful, always understanding, always forgiving, always loving. And they need to come to accept that if they're truly ever going to have a relationship with God.
Thank you.
Pleasure.